Excellency Pak Ong, thank you very much for the nice introduction. Yeah, my name is Luhut Binsar Panjaitan. I was born 68 years ago in a very remote area near Lake Toba. So, yeah, and I spent most of my career in the military. I graduated from Military Academy 1970. And spend most of my time in special forces. I was trained in a very tough training to be a professional soldier. Maybe till today, only few, if not only myself, been to the very tough training in so many special forces training around the world. I was in Fort Bragg in USA, back to 1978. Trained by the U.S. Army Special Forces, and I went to also Special Air Service in the United Kingdom, and I went also to GC9 in Germany. So basically, I was trained to be professional soldiers, how to storm this building or to blow up this building. Not to be a diplomat to, you know, talk about economy, talking about this and that. But this, I think, destiny. You don't know what's going to happen to you. But one day, you have to be this or have to be there. Nobody can predict. So today I'm here with my very good friend, old friend, Professor Leonard. It's a great honor for me to be here. So if I give you my presentation, I hope that can, you know, fulfill your desire. Because if you ask me honestly to all of you, I'm not a professional economic, but if you ask me again to train you how to shoot and how to storm this building, for sure I can give you first class, because I'm the very professional soldier, because I was sent to many military operations around the country. I was parachuting in East Timor back to 1975, December 7. I lost 8 of my soldiers. And yeah, all the way. So now I am here with a very nice tie, you know, and talk in front of you in a very prestigious people. Yeah, I hope that I can, you know, fulfill your expectation about the presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, this is, I think, the title. And this is my presentation. The political situation assessment, I think, very important to all of you to understand. If you look at back to next to the first year before last year, the political situation at the time, this is, I think, the situation. I think the preparation for the election at the time is very tense, because 133 million people, 70% eligible voters at the time. So Pak Jokowi came from nowhere. Can you imagine 3.5 years ago, or maybe four years ago, he's only carpenters in Central Java, a mayor of Solo, and become a governor, and he's facing the very tough challenge from a very famous general. So this is the situation. And Jokowi, 2005, he won the 37%, but in Jakarta 2012, look at this, two stage. The first time ever, he was the first non-incumbent candidate won since 2000. This is, I think, very important. I was there at the time we discussed it with the President Jokowi, who was governor at the time, and I told him, Pak Jokowi, if you won this, governor, ship, and then you're going to be our next president. I said, Pak Luhut. I say yes. Because you see, it's very hard to beat the incumbent. And you are from in the middle of nowhere, Central Java. And he won this 2014. Although it's very, you know, little, but it's very tough election at the time. Next. Now, if you look at also the challenges at the time, you look at this political coalition, national security issues, economic issue. Those three areas is very hard. And everybody at the time was thinking about the political coalition is the biggest problem, because the number of coalition Indonesia, Merah, Putih, against the Koalisi Indonesia Hebat. Look at this composition. You see 91%, so the 52% coalition red and white coalition, while the Jokowi coalition, Indonesia Hebat, only 37%, and the SBY political party, we don't know whether here or here, but in the middle. Sometime, yeah, I don't want to give further comment on that. But this is the situation, many observers predict that with those political configurations, Jokowi will have difficulties to secure parliament. That's always a problem. Now, how do we secure? Everybody came to me and they talk, hey, Pak Luhut, what's going to happen? While the parliament right now controlled by the red and white coalition. I said, we'll see what happened, but I have strong belief we can manage this well as long as the government can prove to the parliament that we have a very good program leaning toward the interest of the people of Indonesia. That's, I think, the bottom line. If the president can show it, can prove it to the people, to the member of the parliament, they cannot do much against us. That's what I believe. Next. Now, we prove it. If you look at the budget revision, this is, I think, one of the very sensitive issues at the time. But we are successful to do so. Again, this is also prove it the maturity of our democracy. The red and white coalition understand the budget very important for the people of Indonesia, understand that this one is good for the people of Indonesia, so they prove it. So this one obstacle, we successfully solve this problem. And number two, the national police and KPK dispute. This is also kind of critical situation, but we are also successful to fix it. Combination President Jokowi and Pak Yusuf Kalla also is a good thing. So with the experience of Pak Yusuf Kalla also support the successful of this coalition to be more natural or to give more support toward the government of Jokowi. Next. Now, what happened today, if you look at this slide, now, this is that in the red and white split party leadership, and red and white coalition on this one, 43%, but they still have some difficulty around here, because the Golkar has a problem, and P3 also has a problem. But if you look at more in the President Jokowi coalition, right now we have 45% something, which is, I think, much stronger than before. But for me, this one not very important. They're very important, how do we work together, how do we sit together? This is part of my job. So how do we convince them this is good for the people of Indonesia, not against your interest? That's again, I would like to say to all of you gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, the maturity of our democracy. Like 2 days ago, we had a very tough meeting about the tax amnesty and KPK revision of KPK law. And we are talking, we are discussing, and we are dealing, as used quote unquote, with a very good way. So we solved the problem. Although we have still some difficulties, but we are moving toward the right direction. Now, this is also, number one, if you look at now, the political situation today, a lot of this, of course, difference from the political observer perception or analysis before. So right now, you see totally different. If you look at also the PAN, right now move toward the coalition with the government, and also the very important, like I mentioned again, is communication between the government and the parliament and the political party. This is, I think, very important in order to build up some understanding how do we build together this country. It's not easy. The communication, I believe, again, the very good tools to overcome a lot of differences. Next. Now, security situation. Next. If you look at the radicalism becomes number one, it's just a serious issue. And we are addressed this issue very much. And this is, I think, police and military and intelligence agencies successful to mapping this, this issue. And we are able to tackle this problem so far. And we established our cooperation quite good, very good to some other countries in order to minimize or to identify the problem about radicalism and de-radicalism. And illegal mining, another issue, number three. Fishing, illegal fishing, illegal fishing, human trafficking, etc. This is another problem that we are facing today. And number two, drugs. Drugs have become a big issue for Indonesia because Indonesia not only the transit for the drugs, the ready destination, also produce some of the drugs. And this is a big problem because across the board, if you look at now Indonesia, for me, drugs even harder than issue of terrorism because drug can penetrate any level of people, any place, across the board. This is always the problem of Indonesia. Pak Ketua, welcome. May I continue, Pak Ketua? This is how good the relation between Parliament and the government. One good example to all of you. Excellency Novanto has a meeting in Singapore, and he just finished his meeting, and he phoned me. He said, "May I drop by and see?" Okay, excellent. This is one thing, you know, that how do we establish our cooperation very good? Such a big country like Indonesia. Everybody, many people thought that it's going to be breakdown, but I can tell you, I can assure you, we are moving toward the right direction. Although we have some differences, but we understand as long as the benefit of the people of Indonesia, we can do it together. Number four, I think the very hot issue about South China Sea, which is, I think, we discussed it quite a lot this morning also with the Minister Vivian, and how do we, you know, face this issue. I think the role of Indonesia being the largest member of ASEAN, together with some member of the ASEAN countries that we can do together in order to keep calm in this situation. Because the Chinese government, I think, quite aggressive on this issue. We have to tackle, we handle this very well, and for the benefit of every country in this region. Next. Now, the rise of the ISIS, this is one issue that as I mentioned earlier, one of the, you know, priority for Indonesia. Right now, if you look at also the son of Samudra, Imam Samudra, already in Syria. So can you imagine now, the son, when the Bali bomb happened back 2002, he was 5 years old. Now he's already a member of ISIS in Syria. So this kind of recruitment done by the ISIS is very dangerous. That is cross the board. You cannot say that in Singapore is immune to this. Look at now Australia, what happened in Australia, because the social media is a very effective and very powerful to change the mind of the people. When you're talking about the ISIS, they have land, they have money, they have infrastructure, they have ideology. Compared to Al-Qaeda, they don't have it. So this one have to work together in order to minimize, to contain the issue of ISIS. And look at now the way their recruitment over there, the structure. They have a very systematic structure over there. They know how do we do it, through what. Look at now in U.S., so many in U.S. U.S. spend $1 billion. I discussed it also with some other friends. You spend billion of dollars. You spend trillion of dollars in Afghanistan and Iraq. What do you get? You get nothing. You lost so many soldiers over there. That's why I said, I don't believe military operation can solve the whole problem. I still believe dialogue and also prosperity could bring some tension lower than just doing the military operation. Military operation is very important, but this is the last sources to solve this problem. Next. Now, counter-terrorism in our country, we have this, this agenda, action and, to counter ISIS. We have hard approach, and we have also soft approach. Hard approach, you are very aware on that, intelligent and military operation. And also, we have law enforcement on this. And we are working very well. I mean, our intelligence agencies and all, as well as the police working together hand in hand. And also, we exchange information with some other countries surrounding this area. And I still believe that we are successful so far. But it doesn't mean that nobody can guarantee that this country is immune, Indonesia or any countries. We have to be careful. We have to watch very much. And we cannot just leave it as is. And nobody one can, you know, assure you that 100% immune. And soft approach, this is, I think, rehabilitation very important. We experience also some of the terrorism already in the jail, in the prison, but they still communicate with other, to some extent, even much harder after they release from the jail. If you look at now Guantanamo, experience from the Guantanamo, this is another experience. They're part of the leader outside after this. So now we have a program. So I'd like to also to invite some of our friends, our countries, neighbors surrounding our Indonesia to work together in order to, you know, minimize the, you know, the ideologies within the ex-terrorism. I think, as I mentioned, also synergize is very important, that we cannot claim any country can do it alone. With this kind of operation, I mean the operation of ISIS worldwide, we have to share intelligence, we have to share information, we have to do it together. Next. Now, drugs and narcotics, as I mentioned earlier, is one of the biggest problems within the country today. We have to work together as well. I think the Singapore and Malaysia imposed a very hard regulation in order to minimize this, but cannot also this one. We have to do it together, exchange information. So that's, I think, the best information. Indonesia right now, size of Indonesia, the largest archipelago country, can you imagine, the coastline of Indonesia. It's not easy to protect Indonesia. So again, as you look at now drugs, it's just across the board. I went to East Java like 5 weeks ago. I went to the old, 18 senior KI, and we discussed about this issue. And they said to me, penetration of these drugs also through pesantren by offering them, like, you know, like, oh, you can you know, you can pray until in the morning with a very good you know, in shape by taking this tablet, you know, that's the tablet is kind of what, ecstasy. So they don't know, because they are from the village. They just take it and then become addicted on this. So this kind of approach, so many. And then to the junior high school, to even to the elementary, they beat like a gum, like many things. So this is also very dangerous to all of us, that we have to work together. Rehabilitation, with the new policy of the government today, we split the rehabilitation, give it to the Ministry of Social Ministry, and also with the Health Ministry, while the drugs dealer give it to the police. So we try to split that one. So we hope that we can minimize. But again, we cannot guarantee on this. It is a common threat. It's a problem all of us. Next. Now, illegal fishing, one issue that Minister of Fishery, Ibu Susi, working very hard on this. She's a very energetic minister, but the result of this, you look at the number, I think increase of fishery product above around 14%, and also growth of our GDP, fishery around 8.64%. Now we work very, very hard on this. So I think we can save quite a lot of fun from this, from this operation. And I believe that government very serious to tackle, to handle this issue. Next. And resolution for South China Sea, this is one of the very hot issue, and I believe Singapore and everybody in this region understand, since the Chinese right now have their own airfield over 3,000 meters, and they have also planned to have their own seaport. It's very, you know, very, very sensitive matter. And the U.S. also have interest in here. Now, how do we approach this issue? Basically, we like to see the dialogue is very important. We understand the nine dash line is this one issue, but we have a joke on this. Yeah, because from the legal perspective, of course, it's still very hard. Or we can discuss this overnight, but we understand maybe the better approach of this, we have to talk. Dialogue is the best approach to solve this problem. And this is very sensitive, of course, because this is a border with Indonesia, also a dispute with the Philippines, with Brunei, Malaysia, and Vietnam. So we discuss it with our counterpart in Singapore, that we can see also in the future, near future, that we can solve this problem nicely. But still very hard, I believe, because again, the national interests already, you know, in this area. While this area is very important, the sea line communication, I think around $5 trillion per year across this area. So we have to keep stability here and peaceful passage for every vessel across this area. Next. Ladies and gentlemen, in terms of military budget, if you look at the slide here, Indonesian budget is considered still very low compared to Singapore. Our budget right now is 0.8% of our GDP, and we are going to increase this to up to 1.5% of our GDP for the next 5 years. So the reason we do so, because we like to modernize our military, have to be go parallelly with our economic growth. And we believe our economic growth can, you know, can move very well for the next few years. And if you look at here also, the budget of Singapore still much higher than Indonesia. Today our budget is $7 billion, while the Singapore nearly $10 billion. So I hope for the next 3 years that we can go up also maybe to around $10 billion or even higher than that. Next. The security foreign and foreign affairs situation. So far, Indonesia successful to maintain or to contain the together with our neighbor in this area. So we do hope that no more or maybe less and influence of ISIS Indonesia. But if you look at now Indonesia also, in we understand we spot in Poso, there are some activities over there, but we deploy our own forces and intelligence, and so far we are successful to do very silent operation in that region. And drugs also another issue that we are working very hard to minimize this problem in Indonesia, and I believe Singapore and Malaysia also doing the same thing. But again, cooperation between or among ASEAN members and also some other countries is very important to minimize this one. Number three, about the South China Sea, again, this is one issue that we have to address very much. And I believe the government of Jokowi already prepared our position or stand position, and this is one of the topics they're going to discuss with President Obama during his visit next week in Washington. I think this is one of the topics that also very important in this region today. Next. Let me move to the economic reforms. Economic reform also, I think, very important for Indonesia. If you look at our slide, the slower economic growth is this. Look at here, I think around the world also like this. Yeah, the Chinese slowed down, maybe right now 5% growth. Yeah, they said 7%, we believe. We discussed it some time ago with some of the professor from Columbia University in New York, and he believed around 5%. But this is also ASEAN, it's stable, slightly down, and in the world also this 3 point something percent. So Indonesia, basically, we're a little bit here, if you compare it in this region, Indonesian growth, if you look at the slide, since 2012, basically from 6.4%, we already slowed down till today. But we believe we can move it today. Here is the today is 4.7%, and I believe third quarter we can go up maybe to around 4.7, 4.8%, and end of this year we can grow maybe to 4.9 or 5% growth. This is, I think, the picture of the our economic growth. Yeah. This is also another problem, Indonesian Gini coefficient. If you look at the last, it's not improving since the president, since the last government. Look at here, the getting worse, but we also target of the government to fix it in the near future. In terms of currency, I think the Indonesian currency right now, we are quite stable. Depreciation of currency, Indonesian currency rupiah, 8.3%, and we believe with the new regulation, deregulation of our government, we can improve better and better in the near future. Next. Now, the quality human resources and demographic bonus, this is another problem for us. If you look at the slide here, still this is the world window of opportunity, only 20 years. If you don't improve the quality of education in Indonesia, especially outside of Java, is going to be backfire for Indonesia in the near future. And look at this one, the slide here, the gap between the in this Java, Papua, and Nusa Tenggara Barat. This is since 2000, the year 2000, this is always parallel. We like to see the gaps, narrowing the gap, but so far we are not successful yet. So we're trying very hard to make this more closer, and then one day have to be one line. So that's why the government give more attention to outside of Java to improve the quality of education in that particular area. Next. This is another problem for Indonesia. If you look at our slide here, logistic cost in Indonesia is very high. That's why infrastructure project is very important for Indonesia, because economy, it is like two sides of the coin. If our economy is not good, then you cannot see the good stability in Indonesia. So look at this one. Indonesia, compared to some other country in this region, we are very, very inefficient. You can look, very inefficiency in Indonesia very much right now. We like to improve it. Look at the transportation cost as well. Like if you compare to Japan, for instance, only 4.9%, while Indonesia 14%. We like also to reduce this one within 3-4 years to maybe around 7-8%. If we are successful to do so, I think we can reduce also the, you know, the overall cost within the country. Today, inefficiency in Indonesia still very much, and we like to tackle this one, yeah, maybe like 50% for the next few years ahead. Next. Now, this is, if you look at ladies and gentlemen's slide here, qualified economic growth is very important. We are not talking only the growth, but we are talking also the equality, because if you are talking only the growth, the rich become richer, but the poor become or stay poor. But what we happen today, what we need today, basically, how do we also give some more opportunity to the middle class to improve? Now, there are decrease of the gap, income gap, like I mentioned in my previous slide, and creation job opportunity and affordable food prices. Number three is very important, ladies and gentlemen, because in this particular time, affordable food and availability of food is very important. If you have this one, like rice, sugar, meat, everything in place, afford by the people, the ordinary people to buy, I think stability within the country is very, very much so. I don't see any much problem in that, because 85% people of Indonesia understand as long as they can buy enough food with the affordable price, I don't see much complaint on that. But some political, some the politician, yes, this has become a big issue. But again, transformer the from the commodity base to the manufacturing base is very, very important for Indonesia. This is, I think, the revolution, if I may say so, because before we rely on commodity. Today, we are moving toward the manufacturing base. So manufacturing base, I will explain later on, give some more benefit to the people of Indonesia. This, I think, collaboration, executive legacy on judicative is very important. Today, I think our collaboration with the parliament, our collaboration with the judicative is moving very well. And law enforcement also right now is very good, and we are working together with any institution in order to make political stability and security stability within the country. Next. Now, this is our strategy, ladies and gentlemen. This is very important. Even distribution of, I think, the development strategy, number one is the even distribution of development outside of Java, like I mentioned about education, like the food, infrastructure. This is, I think, very important. Number two, improving the competitiveness. Yeah, improving human resource quality, conducive investment climate. This is, I think, very important. We have to invite more foreign direct investment to invest in Indonesia. We have to deregulate in order to bring incentive to the investment to investor to invest in Indonesia. And transformation from commodity-based to industrial-based. This is, I think, very important. Provision of raw material export. We don't want to export anymore the raw material. We have to process within the country to see the added value of this. And in development, the downstream industry, you see now more and more. You see, in Sulawesi, for instance, we have a nickel industry. Now we're going down to stainless steel. So you'll see that maybe 20 times of benefit of this, added value of this, if you go down to the stainless steel. Provision of tax holiday. We right now give a more tax holiday to the new investor to invest in Indonesia. Next. Now, this is a thing, ladies and gentlemen, make our economy different than before. In our fiscal room, the burden of our subsidy around $30 billion. But starting this year, the $30 billion, we just maintain around $9 billion, maybe $6 million, because this is by law, we have to keep that to subsidize the poor people. But around $20 billion, I think we allocate to the infrastructures, to the education, to the healthcare, to some others like the slide on the slide you see. So this is, I think, give more flexibility within our state budget. So this one also give room for us to improve the quality of infrastructure, like electricity, toll roads, seaport, airport, etc. Next. Now I look at this one. I think the construction never happened like this before, because I flew to Papua 5 weeks ago. You see the under construction road from Agas to Wamena in with the highland, and you see the connectivity over there. By 2018, we have to complete this road in the within the area in highland in Papua. This is one of the problem in Papua, because we don't give them much attention on this infrastructure. So it's very hard to transport commodities, to transport any goods to the highland. So make like kind of no equality, no prosperity in that region. Next. If you look at now, execution of Trans Sumatra, never happened before. This is 2,700 kilometers. Now you see this one. You can go there. This is under construction now all the way from Bakahuni to Banda Aceh. This is ongoing. We have to finish within 8 years' time. And with this budget that we have today, I don't see that much problem for us. And also the determination of the president and the government today to execute this program, we move it very well so far. Now budget absorption of this is around 50%. It's much faster than people's expectation, because we work together as a team. We remind each other and we go down to the ground and remind them. We see the problem, we talk and solve the problem on the side sometime. And this is under construction, everything. And last time I went to New York, I discussed it with several fund managers, and they challenged me. And I said to one of the lady over there, Catherine, okay, the best way to do it is to come over to Jakarta. You just choose which one you want to go. You go there. If I lie to you, I buy you lunch. If you approve it, you buy me lunch in New York, not in Jakarta. Next. This is in Java. If you look at this one, you have to finish by 2018. So right now we move this one by the one. And this is the area. And we, This one already stranded for some of these projects, stranded maybe 6-7 years. Now we move forward. If you cannot continue this project, and then the government take over this project. Some of the project because of the IRR, and the government will say, okay, leave it to state-owned company to take over this project. The policy of the government, if the IRR is lower than 10%, then state-owned company take over. If the IRR going above 12%, 13%, 14%, leave it to private sector. So we have to see the balance, because otherwise nobody want to invest in that, like in the Sumatra project, for instance. Nobody want to invest because the IRR is very low. But when the connectivity already there, then everybody want to invest in this particular area. Next. Now, groundbreaking, one of the issue about the two-time 1,000 megawatt in Batang in Central Java, stranded nearly 4 years because of land dispute. But the government issued a law basically 2012, but the execution of this law, nobody dare to say so. But the president said, okay, let the independent audit to, an independent appraisal to appraise, and when they appraise, we put 30% above and give 60 days. If we don't fulfill this, send it to the court and then bulldoze. Simple as that. Because the purpose of this for the interest of the people of Indonesia. So I think very firm. The president very firm on this because this one is very important for the benefit of Indonesia. How can we have the good industry while we don't have electricity? Electricity is very important. So this one already groundbreaking last August. So we move forward. Every project right now, when we dispute with the land dispute, always the structure like this. So nobody there right now to challenge the government, because once we are already appraised by the independent appraisal, 30% above, and then 60 days, and then bulldoze. Yeah, a little bit hard. Yeah, we have to do so. This is the new Indonesia. Next. Oh, this is the, I think, agriculture sector. This is one of the problem for us, you know, because agriculture is one of the very important sector for Indonesia. But I'm not trying to blame the other people, you know, but we give very little attention on this. Why we should import rice, for instance, while we have enough? Why should import sugar? Why enough area to do so? But we have to concentrate. We have to give the good seed. We have to give the good fertilizer. We have to control. The problem is control, management. Now the President Jokowi go down to the ground. But the people say, oh, this is the popularity of the president. No, we need this kind of management today. And President Jokowi basically deliver this kind of management, which make me also happy. If you don't do this, what's going to happen? The very important today, the president, the leader should give the good example to the people of Indonesia. So what a good example. He dare to listen to you, he dare to make a decision, he dare to take the responsibility. Then a good example to the people. The people will follow you. That's, I think, the character of the people in Indonesia. If you look at now to Indonesia, step by step, the people understand, the president, so simple. And nobody dare to with the very, you know, very expensive suit anymore, you know. Some with the expensive shoes, except me. Yeah, because my shoes, I told the president, been wearing the, you know, the boots for the last 30 years. So now it's about time for the good shoes, lah. Yeah, I'm joking. Yeah, next. Well, this is the deregulation package 1 through package 4. I think it's very important to all of you, ladies and gentlemen, that how serious government basically. Basically, this regulation, to make it simple, to make it easy to understand, not overlapping each other, you know. Overlapping each other to lock this one. But today, make it simple. So the people right now in Indonesia look at, hey, much easier. We have one, we had one meeting last 2 weeks ago. I will show you later on the slide. That the people trying to, you know, the coordinating from the board, BKPM, trying to, reported to the president saying, oh, we are successful to minimize from 900 days for the electricity to get the purchase price agreement to 200 something days. And the president say, hey, please, Pak Anu Franky, don't report to me. If you go still 200 days, report to me when you can successful to do it 1 month. Why you said we have to wait 3 years to get the license? You have to do it earlier. He said, so much, no, that's your job. The president challenged. So this one I think is very good today, that the spirit to make it easier to the investor to invest in Indonesia. It's like in Singapore, if Singapore can do it, why don't we do it? Like a corporate tax. Corporate tax in Singapore only 17.8%. And the president said, why? And I proposed to the president 19%. Why 18%, Pak Luhut? Make it 18%. Why 19%? Make it 18%. So the president wants to see moving. That's like a TPP. Everybody say scary with TPP. They say, Pak, with the competition, we have to work. We have to live with the competition. We have to improve the quality of our people. We have to improve the quality of our procedures. Something like that, the spirit, I think, right now within the government. Something like this. This is the report by Frankie. Say, oh, Pak, I'm successful, Pak, to do this one. I say, oh, this one, oh, don't report to me like this. If you can successful to do it 30 days, then you report to me. Simple as that. Same, all these things have to, you know, cut, make it faster. Make it faster, easier for the investor to invest in Indonesia. Next. Now, education and social program. Education, one of the problem, as I mentioned earlier to you, bonus demographic bonus in Indonesia like 65%, while the room window of opportunity for it only 20, 25 years. If you're not successful to do so, I'm afraid it's going to be backfire to Indonesia. Right now, introduce also a smart card. It's very important for Indonesia, but we have to be careful on this because sometimes you go too far. Now it can bankrupt this country if we don't be careful with this. So now we calculate again what's the best size of this. So we have to distribute maybe to the province. The province do it for their own, and then some others. Maybe national level they do the other things. Next. Now, if you look at the last slide, ladies and gentlemen, yes, we show you also the confidence is declining, but still higher. If you look at the red, still above this 100% level here. The last, slide, this is below because of the rupiah, I believe. The rupiah, it was declining very much at the time, but now, right now, rebounds. We'll see what happened next month because there's a survey done by our office every month basis. So the sampling is around 1,750 people, so I think quite accurate. So we don't want to lie to you by telling the popularity is good. No, it's still declining, but I believe, if we look at this one, we can go up again. Next. Tax amnesty is another issue that we're going to hope by next week. We're going to see the tax amnesty program. This is now working very much. As you see, the president also very aggressive. Tax penalty only 2% and 4% for the next 4 months, yeah, and move forward. So we are moving this one, and we believe it's very important. Yes, number one, good for the revenue for the government, but the very important is database of this tax amnesty. One, this tax amnesty, the data of this, then we can increase our tax ratio, I believe, within the next 4 or 5 years. Now, our tax ratio only 11.9%. The last 10 years, if you look at the data, maybe only one time we achieved 12%, while the country surrounding Indonesia is around, 15? Like Singapore, I think 17 or 20% tax ratio. We're going to see also Indonesia for the near future around 14-15%. So by doing so, then we'll see this one is going to be much better. But the very important on that also, then number of taxpayers in Indonesia can be increased from the 1 million people to maybe 2-3 million people for the next few years. Because if you look at also the number of middle class also increasing, right now over 40 million, and who own the tax identity, only 27 people, and the people who pay tax, only 1 million people. So you see something wrong with the system. So we have to fix this. By doing so, then also do some changing on the tax law, then we can improve also our tax ratio. Next. Ladies and gentlemen, economic progress. If you look at, I think, to reduce income disparity, this is one of our targets. We are working very hard on that. We like to see no more, I think we can control the instability within the country, what we call it, the unhappiness within the people. Number two is improving economic competitiveness, and we transform from the commodity base to the manufacturing base, which is I think very important for us, and we expect to see the result of this by 2017-18. Of course, it takes some time. So people like to see this overnight solution. I don't believe that we can do so, and nobody can do that. But I believe again by 2017 you will see much better situation within the country. And number two, we believe current implementation of economic program on the right track. We are moving on the right track. We have some resistance, of course, from this reform, what we call it the comfort zone, the people who enjoy with the uncertainty situation. So they can play what I call to Robert from the Brookings, a hanky-panky. Today we minimize the hanky-panky within the country because very clear regulation. No more like before. You cannot deal with the regulation anymore. You have straight forward. This is the regulation. It can work within the regulation. And number three, I think we believe that we can successful to this to achieve our target. And we believe also the economic growth and stability, security can be worked together in the near future. Ladies and gentlemen, next. The resolving of the forest fire. This is one issue I think special for our friend Singaporean. It's very important. Yeah, this is the situation today per October 18, 7 to 10 p.m. Because every day I get the report about this. This is situation. If you look at now, this in Sumatra, this is in Kalimantan. You see the spot, a hot spot, many thing here. Most of the hot spot in here, all in the peatland. Here in the peatland as well. So the peatland we experienced very hard to tackle, and we discussed it very much. I went there, and we deployed so many airplanes, and we combined water and chemical. Yes, good, but some of this airplane cannot carry the water with the chemical. So this one handicap. But so far, also with El Nino, I have to be honest to all of you, ladies and gentlemen, it's very hard to deal with this peatland. Peatland, I went there, it's just some of the thickness of this peatland, maybe 5 meters, 6 meters, maybe 50 centimeters, something like that. It's very hard. The problem also, because the bad habit of the people, I have to honest to you, for them, time to time, is a habit again. When the dry season, they burn for their own purpose. Some of them, some of this for their own purpose. Some of them, when they clean the land, they can sell the land higher price to the other people. But never happened before that the El Nino, the period of El Nino so long like this today. Normally for them when they burn August, September, or September, October, it's raining. Then no more fire. But this time, no rain until today. And the prediction of our meteorologist is going to be until November end. This kind of make it even more drier on the pit, so even harder for us to solve this problem. I think the Singaporean Chinook also experienced with this how difficult this issue. Next, this is the plantation. If you look at this one, it is very much so. And look at this one also. I flew in the helicopter. I saw it from the ground. It is maybe less than 100 meter, like this one. And this one already just water bombing. Like 2 hours later, we came here and already burning. I went here and my feet just dropped to the peatland. Hurt my feet is difficult. I went here. I was here. It's very hard. I'm going to see that peatland again tomorrow to make sure what's the progress. Because today, the PSI in Singapore above 200 again, 100 something, which is very high. But again, I told to my friend in the government of Singapore, I said, hey, don't worry, don't push us too much, Because we have a problem domestically. They punch our people, punch us now, uppercut, jab, So you don't need to talk too much, too strong about this, Don't worry, we have enough, Every day we get telephone call, we have problem here, the PSI ready 300, 500, 600, 700. You're talking below 100, okay lah. Yeah. I'm not saying excuse this one. I'm just telling you how difficult this one. We are serious to tackle this one. Not because of you. Yes, you are another issue, but internally we have a problem now. Yeah. You see, the problem about health, the problem about schooling, the problem about so many things. So we are serious to do this. I was called by the parliament to report to this to the parliament. And we reported to the parliament. Before the parliament said, bam, bam, I said, Pa, why don't you join us, go there and see what happened over there. Instead of just talking outside, we dispute outside. We go together and then solve the problem. Next. Now this is, the El Nino issue. If you look at El Nino, the highest, the worst one is 1997, 1998, this one. But now even worse than that. Much worse than 1997. So we are dealing with this issue not now. If you look at this report, October, look at still no rain here. This is Sumatra, this is Java. Still dry. And November, look at still dry. Then hopefully by December, it's going to be okay. So we are very much in the critical situation in South Sumatra. Now, South Sumatra is a source of haze. Not much anymore in Riau or Jambi. And some others in Kalimantan. If you look at the Kalimantan, it's still very clean here in this Kalimantan. Yeah. So this is, I think, the problem right now over there. Next. Now, the current El Nino badly likes it. Hey, this is also in South Sumatra. Yeah, sorry. Here in Ogan Komering. And visibility is one issue. Because sometimes you cannot see. When I was there, the visibility around 600. I can imagine 100. 600 is very close already. But I flew there, still flew with the Air Force airplane. Of course, they're there to do so. But turboprop, not jet. Jet, I don't think that you can do it. Next. But we have right now, there is a Chinook, we get from Singapore, test flight, 18 of October, and you have also another Chinook, the water bombing, but sometime they're not flying because of the visibility. The bombardier Malaysia, that's very, very effective, this one, I should say. The Malaysian Pelican, this is very effective, they can carry the scooping airplane. This is one of our prima donna today. And Hercules CU-130 returned to Australia because they have also a problem in Australia. So, not only in Indonesia, in Australia also 500,000 hectares. Now fire over there, also, like in also in Canada. So today we get two scooping airplane from Russia. And starting tomorrow, they are working already, and we do hope that we can help also to reduce haze in Singapore. I'm not talking now Indonesia, because by this they can carry like 12,000 to 15,000 liter per one sortie. So they can go up maybe 10 sorties a day. I hope that this, and then they also allow us to mix this water with the chemical. So we hope that we can, do something much better than what happened today. Next. Okay, this is, I think, the short-term mitigation measures that we are doing like this, and you are aware on this. And number one, of course, it's not easy operation, but we have our own task force over there in South Kalimantan, South Sumatra. We have also task force in Jambi, Riau, and some other area. Next. No more, I think, support. We like, I raised this issue. Maybe the Singaporean can help us, but not with Chinook. Chinook is not very effective, I should say. Maybe you can help us like Pelican, which is also one of our, one of the very effective airplane to deal with this kind of problem. Next. Ladies and gentlemen, next. Yeah, this is my last slide. I do hope that it gives you some more understanding about Indonesia. If I may conclude my presentation here, the government moving quite well, and we are on the right track on the economy. We are tackling the haze very much, and next year we are going to impose much more tough action against the owner of the plantation in Indonesia. So again, Hope that you get some more understanding about Indonesia, and I do hope that you can come over to Indonesia and we work together, and more than happy to share our information. And don't hesitate to do whatever you like to invest in Indonesia or to convince your friends to invest in Indonesia. I'm more than happy to help all of you. Thank you very much.